How you doing, guys? It's Alessandro here from Spicy Moustache with some new tips in order to help you create in your own green area, indoor or outdoor, following the principles of do as nature does. We've now entered the spring season and it is time to start thinking what to plant and where to plant it in your garden. The reason is that not every plant thrives good with other plants, but they've got their own preferences. So you can't just randomly allocate plants all over your garden, because a bad plant pairing could potentially doom a garden to failure. On the other hand, if you pair your plants properly, you might improve the flavor of your harvest, repel pests and disease, and maximize your harvest in a small space. So dig up that like button, and today I'll show you all you need to know about companion planting. The history of companion planting stretches way beyond the last century. From the writings of Marcus Terentius Varro, in his book about agriculture, written in the 2nd century BCE, we know that not only the Romans, but even the Greeks, were well aware of the effects of some plants on their neighbors. For example, the Romans had observed that walnut trees stopped older plants to grow. This is due to allelopathy, the way that certain plants secrete substances into the soil to either allow other plants to grow or to inhibit their growth. This is a self-defense mechanism of some plants to allow themselves to grow. Chinese farmers started to use mosquito ferns as a companion planting to rice crops at least 1,000 years ago. The native people of America were using a form of companion planting at least 8,000-10,000 years ago. Almost any article that you find about companion planting references the Native American three-sister planting. This involves growing corn, beans and squash, often pumpkins, in the same growing area. As the corn stalks grow, the beans naturally find support to climb up. Beans, as all legumes, fix nitrogen into the soil, which supports the high request of nutrients from the corn. Squash grows rapidly, and their large leaves act like mulch to protect the soil and also to inhibit the growth of most of the weeds. So as you can see, good companion planting work in support of each other. If used correctly, companion planting has a lot of different benefits for your garden, especially if you have a small growing space and you want to get the best out of it. Today I met up with Jack, who has a small market garden here in London, and he used different techniques including permaculture, no-till and companion planting to grow his food.
Yo, what's up guys? I'm Jack, owner of Jack's Patch. I'm an urban farmer from London. And today we're at a quarter acre market garden here in Essex, where I use principles like no dig and permaculture, and I try to get you guys to grow online as well. Today on the farm, we're gonna show you how to do companion planting. Even though we're on a quarter acre here, doesn't matter how big or small, we focus on every square foot to maximize production.
So yeah, tell me more about companion planting. Why? What are the benefits? Why to use it in the garden?
So we're trying to deter pests. We're trying to maximize harvest as well. So the reason I grow like so many different types, biodiversity is one of those. So we don't have to use pesticides, which is like a massive, massive bonus.
Yeah, right.
We're trying to get more plants in. Like obviously all plants need space to grow to size, but some have like friendly plants and some like each other, some don't like each other. So we try and find ones that like each other. There's like companion planting apps, like Veggie Garden, or you can go on Google. There's like charts and all sorts. But there's some really basic ones, like we were just talking about, as you were saying, tomato and basil.
Oh, that's like a combo, right, to have in the garden?
Yeah, so the smell of the basil deters away, like the black fly, green fly, away from the tomato. And for example, today we're going to be showing you how to maximize space with lettuce and spring onion by using, as we plant the lettuce, the cross section in between of the lettuces, we can grow something up, and spring onion is something great as well.
That helps to maximize the harvest in the end, and also to repel all the pests, right?
Yeah, exactly that. So for example, like smell of like the onion, like certain things hate as well. And ultimately we're getting a lot more crop. As we said at the start of the video, every square foot counts, and if we maximize that biodiversity in that square foot, then the garden benefits, the soil benefits, it's just a win-win.
And does companion planting affect the actual flavor of the vegetables that you're gonna harvest, or it doesn't matter?
I'm not sure like if it matters too much, but like for example, as we mentioned, the tomato basil affects the flavor. But one that was a real difference when I was mainly on my allotment, I used to grow mint in the ground, which we know like we grow in pots now because it spreads like crazy.
But a mint,
you give yourself a headache in the next season. But yeah, mint and peas like actually affected the flavor so much. The peas taste is so much different. But a little saying I always say, if it grows well together, you can eat together.
So using companion planting is also a great way to, let's say, repel pests in the garden, right?
Yeah.
And attract these predatory like insects that could potentially remove all these pests from your garden, right?
Yeah, so I saw a massive, massive reduction in pest issues just by adding those beneficial plants, pollinators, you're getting the good insects to kill the bad insects. And also as well, it's an attractive thing. You look at your garden, it's a lot brighter, more biodiversity, but you're doing exactly that. You are creating a perfect ecosystem so it can thrive instead of being like damaged. And some plants as well, like the smell of the roots, deter away certain bad pests that eat your plants.
It helped a lot, even in my garden. Like last year, I used some plants like marigold or nasturtium. It's a great plant. They kind of distract the insects.
So the bad insects will actually attack those sometimes. They're like nasturtiums, caterpillars love them. So yeah, it's a great way.
It's also lovely to eat.
It's a win-win, beneficial, right? Thing. Yeah, grow it, eat it as well. Like, so most of the flowers here are edible, which is great. So we're going to do a bit more explanation on this. So this is like how the Americans do. It's a 30-inch bed, and that gridder comes in 5-inch, so it's just a 20-inch wide. So it's 10-inch by 10-inch apart. And then what we're doing with the spring onions is in the grid section of like lettuce, 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 we're putting the spring onion in between. So this space is going to be not covered by the circumference of the lettuce itself, but will then grow tall in between, and you're going to have a nice full bed. And when the bed's full as well, it's keeping that moisture in the ground. It keeps the soil cool, optimum temperatures for great growth.
Meeting with Jack was absolutely great, especially because I had the chance to have a look at how to take care of a bigger space than mine here in London. You can find the link for his profile in the description of the video, and I will also attach a full guide about companion planting and how to use them in your garden. As many gardeners know, there are also certain plants that should never be planted together. You might risk nutrient deficiencies, lack of sunlight, and also it could potentially spread some kind of disease. A lot of new gardeners choose the plants for how they look, and they don't really look at the tags. You should always avoid grouping together plants that have opposite wants. For example, tomato and corn might be like a classic summertime plate, but don't plant tomato near corn. These heavy feeders compete to each other for the same nutrients. So it might end up that they deprive the soil from nutrients if it's not super rich. They also share a common pest called the tomato fruit worm that could easily spread between the plants and kill them both. Another example are cucumber and basil. Seasoned gardeners find that the vegetable don't grow really well close to basil, marjoram, and sage. The reason is that herbs with a strong scent and flavor has an effect on the taste of the growing cucumber. One herb that it does like though is dill, which attracts predatory pests and overflies, which are really beneficial for your garden. I will also attach a link to the description of the video so you can check which plant shouldn't be planted near each other. Companion planting is just another growing method that you could apply to your growing space to maximize your harvest. When I started gardening, I used to leave big gaps in between plants because I was following plant spacing and wasting a lot of space. However, don't get too obsessed about pairing vegetables. Sunlight, water frequencies, and good soil management are the most important aspects for your garden. I hope you liked today's video, and if so, please subscribe to my channel, turn on the notification setting so you can be notified every time I post a new video, and I'll see you next week for a new episode. Thank you so much for watching. See ya.